Welcome to the two-part finale of the Richmond Feds District Dialogue Series. Today, we'll be moving beyond K-12 education and into the world beyond high school, whether that's community college, a four-year university, or the workforce. In session five, I'll be talking with college administrators and nonprofit leaders to learn about how the COVID-19 pandemic has affected post-secondary students and institutions, and what communities can do to support them. In session six, we'll be joined by employers and researchers to talk about the effects of the pandemic on workers. If you're watching live, please type any questions or comments into the live chat on YouTube. I'll be monitoring them so that I can respond. We also hope that you'll join the conversation on social media by using the hashtag District Dialogues. If you're watching a replay, please continue to use the hashtags because we want this to be an ongoing conversation. And be sure to tag us in your social media posts so that we can see them. As we'll explore more in detail in a few minutes, college enrollment is down this year, particularly at community colleges, which tend to serve the population most harmed by educational disruptions and by job losses. But that's not true everywhere, which is what led me to visit Vance County, North Carolina, a rural community near the Virginia border. Even in the midst of the pandemic, Vance County and its surrounding area is successfully connecting people to education opportunities and to jobs. So earlier this month, I visited with Dr. Jerry Edmonds, VP of Workforce and Community at Vance Granville Community College, and Lou Grillo, Director of Workforce Development at the Kerr-Tar Regional Council of Governments, to learn more about how they're doing it.
Let me tell you a little bit about Vance Granville Community College. Vance Granville Community College services four counties, Vance, Granville, Warren, and Franklin counties. We are in an area that is deemed by the state of North Carolina as being distressed. So needless to say, socioeconomic concerns are at the foremost of many of our students. Many of our students come from backgrounds that aren't ideal, but nonetheless, they're able to get a quality education here at Vance Granville Community College. My name is Jerry Edmonds. I'm proud to serve as the Vice President of Workforce and Community Engagement here at Vance Granville Community College.
My name is Lou Grillo, and I'm the Director of Workforce Development for the Kerr-Tar Regional Council of Governments and the Kerr-Tar Workforce Development Board.
We have a wide range of students. We do service students that are curriculum-focused, that wish to have a two-year associate's degree, and we also service non-credit students, and those students are often seeking a short-term credential, and they are the traditional vocational trades, which are very, very important in today's economy, and especially in small rural communities. On the curriculum side, approximately 65% of those students are female, with 35% being male. On the non-curriculum side, it's the exact inverse. Approximately 65% of those students are male and about 35% that are female. Our students, even prior to COVID, obviously faced a number of challenges. COVID has exacerbated a lot of those.
One of the major barriers was really just the availability of skills and people having the skills that the employers were looking for. The key skills that we're seeing are needed in the workforce today, I think they've been called soft skills. Right now we have a big change going on. If we think about manufacturing in the days of old, you think about the line worker, and now there's a great preponderance of technology that's being used in robotics in the manufacturing world that we have. Now, just being able to show up and think they can put you to work is not really the way it works. People need to come in and really understand what it takes to be a part of a team. A lot of times to get the work done, what it is, some basic skills, some problem solving skills. But another part of that is the silver tsunami, as they're calling it, with a lot of our older workers exiting, and they're leaving with a lot of skills that are unique to their jobs, unique to the machinery that they're working on. And just our ability to replace that workforce expediently has been a challenge.
Right now, as the workforce is changing, it's a dichotomy to understand why it is that unemployment in a lot of communities double digit, but yet there's not enough supply to meet the demand that our local employer has. The pandemic has certainly made us reconsider how we connect both our students to employers. Our job has been to educate and send out prepared to find those occupations. But we're placing more of a focus on maintaining contact with our graduates so that when those employers come to us, hey, we have a pool of ready candidates, which is more and more what is being required of us.
What's made us successful is really our partnerships. I'm talking about economic development, community college system, our K-12 partners, our vocational rehab, just all of our partners, our veteran services. We all try to come together to find out what's available, to share opportunities, to share concerns. Economic development, without question, has probably been one of our best partners. They just have the relationships with the companies. Just having employers at the table and really understanding that we need to be responsive to their current needs.
We've recently experienced a slight decline in enrollment. I'll tell you, early on, we actually saw slight increases in enrollment. That was primarily due to, we feel, some of the programs that we continue to bring on board, such as the CDL truck driving course, which that was the spring of 2020 was the first cohort for that course. In addition to that, we did intentional marketing. I would say that the combination of those two factors and also of adding financial incentives. We're really proud of our CDL truck driving program, whereby we're now in our third cohort. To date, we've graduated 32 students through that program, and over 90% of those students had jobs waiting on them when they graduated. We have students that within a 9-week time frame are going from being unemployed to making $60,000 to $70,000 in a 9-week period at a cost of less than $2,000. It's a very expensive program to operate. As you may imagine, the cost of the big rigs exceed $100,000, and you typically need to have between 4 and 10 of those trucks to have a successful program. Another course extremely popular with our local manufacturers is called Production Technology. Students that graduate that 96-hour course walk away with 4 industry credentials after just 16 days. They do the basic forklift training certificate. They have basic safety skills. They have Lean Six Sigma, of course, and then they have the National Career Readiness CRC certificate, which speaks to the soft skills lacking from students and adults as well in our community. Last week when we graduated those students, we have over 10 local companies that were here on campus clamoring over those students. In terms of the barriers to scaling the programs for many of our short-term workforce development courses, it's having the instructors. Many of them own their own businesses, and even if they work for someone else in a skilled trade, they're making far more money in the private sector than we can afford to pay them. If we look at our CDL program, we are doing that in partnership with Caldwell Community College. We have them on campus, and their instructors are teaching our students. Caldwell Community College is about a 3-hour drive from here, so it's quite a commitment for them. We're hoping for longer-term funding because, obviously, the COVID-19 pandemic will have far-reaching implications. So we are hoping that some of the funding that we're receiving on a state and federal level will continue. But we're also making plans that will be permanent as well. Community colleges do a really, really good job of educating our students, but not so great of a job of telling our story all the time. And that's just plain old marketing.
If there's an opportunity to increase funding when it comes to outreach, that's just really where it is right now. If we could have more funding to support those activities, to communicate, you know, what's available in the area, and also to foster that communication between the students and the employers, some of the companies that are being the most successful are the ones that continue to use the digital platforms that can help them communicate the opportunities that they have available. In light of students not moving on the college, about students, you know, kind of apprehensive of what the future brings, so they're electing to look at the workforce. And we think that could be a good thing, you know, understanding that they could pick up skills that they can later put on their resume.
Community college is on par with any other, and our students are on par with any other students that go on to university, and that a lot of the programs, and especially those programs in workforce development, short-term training, lead to careers that are very lucrative. They provide with living wages that one can support a family with. And often that message is not lost on educators, on K-12. It's not lost on policymakers, but often it's our parents, it's our grandparents, and it's even those other colleagues in high school. It's those students who love to be able to laud the fact that they were accepted into an Ivy League school or into a university. That's wonderful. I'm not taking anything away from that. But a student who also wishes to go into the trades should be just as celebrated as a student that just got admitted to a four-year university school.
Enrollment has increased at Vance Granville, but that's not the case nationwide. The number of undergraduate students has been declining for several years, but the drop was especially pronounced last fall, nearly 4% overall, compared to less than 2% the year before. Community colleges took the worst hit, with enrollment declines of more than 10%. This was surprising because it's the opposite of what we usually see during downturns. During recessions in the early 1990s and early 2000s, and especially during the Great Recession, community college enrollment increased, but during the COVID recession, it plummeted along with GDP. This decline in community college enrollment varied by race and gender. Among men, the smallest declines were for Asian students, followed by whites and Hispanics. Black and Native American enrollment fell the most. Among women, Asian enrollment declined only slightly. Hispanic female enrollment fell 6%, followed by whites at 7%. Black and Native American female enrollment dropped 9%. There was also wide variation by state, ranging from a 26.2% decline in West Virginia to a 3% increase in South Dakota. In most of the 5th District, community college enrollment dropped around 3 to 6%. Students cited a wide range of reasons for canceling their plan for post-secondary education. The most common reasons were concerns about contracting COVID-19 and an inability to pay for classes because of pandemic-related income loss. Looking ahead, the impact may be felt beyond this year. FAFSA applications have declined nationwide compared to the same time last year, which suggests fewer students are contemplating college in the future. In the 5th District, the FAFSA drop was especially large in West Virginia. College enrollment isn't the only number that matters, because many students who attend college don't end up completing college. Overall, only about 60% of students who enroll in college complete a degree within 6 years, ranging from 77% at private nonprofit four-year schools to just 40% at public two-year colleges. As with many other educational outcomes, college completion rates tend to be lower for Black and Hispanic students than for white and Asian students, and lower for students from lower-income families. Only 26% of dependent students from the lowest income quartile earn a bachelor's degree within 6 years of enrolling in college, compared to almost 70% of students in the highest income quartile.
As we just saw in the data, lots of students who enroll in college don't graduate, which points to the need for comprehensive strategies to support students' academic, social, and emotional needs. To dive into this a little more, I'm now joined by Dr. Jan Gullickson, president of Germanna Community College in Fredericksburg, Virginia, and Dr. Sarah Heminger, co-founder and CEO of THREAD, a nonprofit that works to support Baltimore students throughout their educational journey and beyond. Sarah, we'll start with you. Can you tell us a little bit about THREAD?
We're trying to knit together community in Baltimore. The way that we do that is we enroll high school freshmen who rank academically in the bottom 25% of their class, but they're exceptional individuals just in very extraordinary circumstances. And then they stay with us for 10 years. So it's all of high school and 6 years after high school. And during that time, we have up to 4 volunteers who get to know that young person and their family and vice versa. So the idea is for the relationships, both amongst the young person, their family, the volunteers, and their families become inextricably linked.
So Jan, I know you're from another organization that works with a lot of people in the community. Can you tell us a little bit about Germana Community College?
Germana is a comprehensive community college. We're in both a kind of a suburban area, Northern Virginia, as well as a rural area. We cover a territory about the size of Delaware. We have over 7,200 students right now. In the last 3 years, we've grown 8% in enrollment, which I think is unusual in not just in Virginia, but in the country for colleges to grow in enrollment. And we've done that through some very deliberative disruption that we have undertaken and really have found to be successful in not only attracting students, but keeping students as well.
Yeah, so tell me a little bit about those programs, and I'm interested how your approaches needed to shift during the COVID-19 pandemic.
Sure. One of the probably most disruptive thing we have done, and it really relates to what Sarah's talking about, is we are intrusive in our caregiving. We have a set-aside care team for the college that really helps students with all kinds of issues that come up, which might include we buy them computers, we give them gas money, we deliver food during COVID. We delivered food to their homes because they couldn't come to our food pantries on campuses. We have food drives where people come through and pick up food. COVID has been disruptive in those interpersonal relationships. So what we have tried to do is to embed them into the electronic course experience. So we have counselors embedded in some of our programs in the courses themselves. We have tutoring embedded in the courses themselves. We have, as I said, an email that you're just one email away from all the help that you need that to make it through. And what's very interesting about folks, and I think what's so important about Sarah's work too, is that to know that you have a place to seek out that cares about you is an incredible safety net for those students needing it, even if they don't reach out that often, but they know it's there. Mm-hmm. So there has been a lot of disruption during COVID, but we've also learned to do our work much better. We've spent a lot of money with our faculty so they know how to teach in an online environment. And we also have spent untold amounts, honestly, thanks to some federal infusion of cash, on just getting students through those steps that are barriers for many of them.
Mm-hmm. As we move post-COVID, hopefully in the near future, do you plan to keep some of these changes permanent?
Absolutely. In fact, we surveyed our students, and what we found, about 70% of them want to stay online primarily. Mm-hmm. And the reason for that is that they work full-time jobs, they have children, they have family, they have all the responsibilities that you and I might have. So we, this fall at least, are going to be about 70% online. And that includes both our services and our instruction. We're also keeping a lot of the embedded support in the classes so that tutoring, for example, is one click away for students.
So, Jan, I know there's no such thing as a typical community college student. I know you serve very young students who are still in high school all the way through people who are coming for a one-time kind of continuing ed class to folks that are there to become welders. But talk to us a little bit about the challenges that you do commonly see amongst your community college students and then how you work to address those challenges in the services you provide.
There's a program that we use for our students, and they range from all ages, from the 16-year-old to the 60-year-old, called Single Stop. And that allows us to pair the student with the community-based benefits. Maybe it's SNAP, maybe it's housing allowances, maybe it's transportation assistance. So we've, in the last year, helped about 300 of our students, and they've secured $376,000 worth of benefits as a result. So what we really are doing is keeping that safety net together for our students enough by patching all these things in so that they can get through this and get on to their lives. Because we know the students who hang in there, the bottom 25%, if you would, because many of those are the students we serve too, are not incapable, but sometimes they are just overlaid with barrier upon barrier. So our job is to blow up the barriers for those students and make the pathway easy as we can.
So I'm assuming then that some of the youth that you begin to support as freshmen end up on a path to a community college, like Jan's describing. What are the biggest needs of your students when they're making that transition to post-secondary education and or the workforce?
In high school, it's a little bit easier because we all have a shared goal, for most of our young people, that is to graduate from high school. After high school, there's some divergence. And so one of the things we spend a lot of time thinking through is, are there ways to have students who are on overlapping pathways go on those paths and those journeys together? And so we have some students who go to a four-year university, some to a community college, others into certification programs, some straight to workforce, and then others are entrepreneurs. I think the one thing, though, that the vast majority of our young people experience is, regardless of which pathway they're stepping into as adults, they really are stepping into a world that isn't meant for them. Mm-hmm. And I think that is, they encounter it in different ways, in different places, but it's constant and it's exhausting. Most of our environments, regardless if it's workforce or if it's a post-secondary, it just it hasn't been co-created with them. Our volunteers are also the same people who are working in those companies that are teaching at those institutions. And so a lot of our work is really, as the adults go, as we go on our journey, our hope is that, and this is why we focus our work in Baltimore, is that we hit a critical mass where you have not just a tightly woven fabric of people in relationship with one another, but that you start to impact the culture of the religious institutions, the corporations, the universities that our young people are stepping into in a way that lends itself to that deeper sense of belonging and cultural affirmation of who they are and the incredible and resilient history that they have and that their families have. And so, yes, I'd love to remove some of the more practical barriers, but if I could address any barrier, it would really be the culture that exists that our young people encounter every day. And it would be to remove that othering and that exhaustion, if I could, wave a magic wand.
So I'm curious, Sarah, as you have created Thread in Baltimore, have you thought about how this can be scaled to help students in other communities and how you could scale it other places? Has that been done?
Over time, we've been invited to expand to, I think at this point, more than 30 different cities. We ask our young people and volunteers from our earlier cohorts, like, what what led to this outcome? Like, how did you go from here to here? And they very quickly started describing a very particular type of interaction between themselves and the adult. We started to unpack that there were these underlying norms that were present in the relationships that were sticky. And so kind of last few years, what we've been doing is codifying those in two ways. One, into a curriculum that you could actually use, and we use it to help facilitate relationships between our volunteers and our young people, but we also use it to help facilitate relationships between collaborators in Thread. So collaborators are partners who might host our young people for a summer job. We can provide kind of this curriculum training for the employers. And so as we've codified it, we've also built tools. So we have an app that has been critical during this time, especially because it allows our community to connect in a very social way online. And it also enabled us to kind of know if people were okay. So we saw, because of our ability to track it, we saw a 90% increase in the interactions between young people and volunteers in the first few weeks of COVID. So the visibility into that now allows us to maybe think about not just potentially expanding direct services in other locations, but it's actually, are there ways to take the lessons that we've learned? Because as we've grown, we've had to get much more skilled in our ability to do this.
So Jen, if you were in charge of federal and state or state policy for a day, if you were in charge for a day, what's the first policy change you would make that would really help you serve your students better?
I would definitely support the community resources who are successful, like THREAD. And actually, THREAD has a great model, and we should look at that. We should get that app and make it work at our college. So I would surely support the nonprofits that are out there changing the world. But I think from an educational policy point of view, and this is radical, is I would turn the funding model upside down. If you went to any state, you would see that the majority of the money in that state goes to university level education. Science, research and science institutions, for example. And the least amount of money goes to community colleges. And yet, we're the ones who know how to take students through a successful walk and really get them to the workforce, to meet the workforce needs of employers. So I would turn it upside down, give community colleges the most money in our country, and then regional universities, and then R1 institutions.
Sarah, how about you? What's the policy change you would make that you think would better support the high school students that you serve?
Our general stance is that in order to really see sustained change, you have to both have changes to policy, but you also have to, alongside that, do the deep individual and interpersonal work. Otherwise, you know, you end up with situations like where we are here in Baltimore, but most cities, which is we pass legislation to integrate the school systems, but the school system here is actually more segregated than it was in 1954, because it's now segregated by both race and by class. Mm-hmm. So I think just paying careful attention to the importance of it's a both and, not an either or. And I just, Jan, I feel like everything that you're saying is just this acknowledgement. What is actually, I think, beautifully radical is just the sheer acknowledgement of our being inextricably linked. So not thinking about things in pockets, but that just understanding that if our neighbor isn't okay, we're actually not okay until, you know, we're all. So thinking about it in a more holistic way, I think that would be more a general comment around policy is not actually bucketing them in, okay, well, this is for transportation, this is for education, but how can we look at it holistically and look at the interdependence that different pieces of policy have on one another?
That's great. I feel much better about the world knowing that folks like you two are working hard to make sure that people are okay. And I really appreciate the time you've spent with us today. I'm now joined by Dr. Wayne Frederick, president of Howard University in Washington, D.C., to discuss the unique role and value of HBCUs in the context of COVID-19. Dr. Frederick is a renowned surgical oncologist and was appointed president of Howard in 2014.
Dr. Frederick, thanks so much for joining us this morning.
Thanks for having me.
So let's jump right in and talk about where Howard is right now. So what's your current status? Are your students, are your classes in person, remote, hybrid?
Yeah, the majority of our classes are remote for almost all of our undergrad. However, we have a significant health sciences component. And so the students who are doing clinical rotations are in person, as you would imagine. So they've been vaccinated appropriately, but they've been participating in in-person instruction to facilitate getting through their clinical clerkships.
I'm curious if your decision to remain remote, mostly for undergraduate students, One of the things that we've heard from, especially the K through 12 educators we've talked about, is the disproportionate impact COVID has had on communities of color, and also how that's impacted parents' decisions to keep their kids remote if they have that option. Did that factor into your decision to remain remote?
Yeah, most certainly. We employ more African-American faculty than any four-year private institution in the country. And so that disproportionate impact was of a concern. If our employees weren't directly impacted, they probably had family members who were impacted. Our faculty and our students would have fallen into that category as well. And so we felt that it was important to, one, keep them safe, but two, to recognize that they may have more struggles than the rest of the country, especially when you look at where the unemployment rate went to. And we felt that that would be, a critical factor would impact our entire community. So with all of that, we decided to stay remote for the most part.
So I know nationwide college enrollment declined more so at the two-year institution level than the four-year institution level. But how was Howard's enrollment affected in the fall of 2020? And what is it looking like for fall 2021?
Yeah, you're right. Higher ed enrollment was down about 3.4%, I think, across the board. We had a 17% increase in our enrollment in the fall. So we went from some 9,400 students to 10,900. A lot of that had to do with a larger incoming class, but also it had to do with significant retention. This fall, it's looking encouraging. Again, we had a 30% increase in applications for our undergrad campus. And we had significant increases of about 30% across the board to our other schools and colleges, like the medical school, law school. We had significant increases in applications as well. So the demand for Howard education has increased.
That's great. So I know that, like a lot of other schools across the country, Howard stopped requiring standardized tests last year for admission. Was that a result of the pandemic, or is it something you had already been considering over time? And then I'm curious if you think that has played a role in that sharp increase in the number of applications.
We certainly waived it because of the pandemic. I would say the increase in applications certainly may be related to that. Students who have, you know, strong GPAs but may not take standardized tests well, or have taken it and the scores aren't great, are probably a little more apt to apply to more schools, believing that they have a better opportunity. We have to take a more holistic approach to admissions, whether or not test scores come back as part of our admission process. I think that review is going to continue to prove to be critical.
Do you think there's going to be a lot of pressure to not bring back the tests as a requirement, just overall for higher ed?
Yeah, I think there'll be some pressure, but I worry about it, to be quite honest. And I know I may be in a minority about this, but one of the things that I'm concerned about is that we may then start using zip codes and so on as a surrogate, for things like that. And you can do that in the background without, you know, a whole lot of detection. And I think there is evidence to support that the test is culturally biased, but I do have some concerns that it may not be, you know, as linear a relationship as people think, and that just simply eliminating it is going to make the playing ground more level.
Nationwide, HBCUs tend to serve higher percentages of Pell-eligible students and first-generation college students. Is that the case for the undergraduate students you serve at Howard? Can you give us a little insight into who the students are at Howard?
Yeah, if you look at the four-year private institutions in D.C., the percentage of Pell Grant students ranges anywhere from 10% to, I think, 19%. At Howard, it's 46% of my undergrad population. So it's definitely significantly skewed. At HBCUs, you can get Pell Grant representation as high as 80%. So certainly HBCUs are taking on a more, I would say, under-resourced student. We're certainly doing that at Howard, but our graduation rate for our Pell Grant students, according to the last U.S. News and World Report, is the fifth highest in the country and the highest among private institutions, with only four public schools in the California state system having a higher graduation rate than we do. So while those students certainly are, you know, compromised around income, et cetera, and finances, they certainly do well when we get them here.
During your tenure as president, you've made significant progress in increasing both retention rates and graduation rates. So I'm curious how you've achieved that.
Yeah, you know, we've done a couple of unique things. We stood up an Office of Undergraduate Studies, and then embedded in there, we did things like we started a GUT 15 program, shamelessly following the GUT Milk program. And that was to encourage students to take at least 15 credits a semester. One of the first things I recognized when I came into the job is that almost 30 to 40% of my freshmen were taking less than 30 credits a year, their first year. And so they, even if they progress to the second year, they weren't considered sophomores because they didn't have enough credits. We increased the number of credits you could take per semester from 18 to 21, basically creating a three-year scheme where if you took 20 a semester, if you were capable of doing that, you could actually graduate in 3 years. And we rewarded those students. So we now have a three-year graduation rate that was negligible before we started this, and now it's at 3%. Of our population is graduating in 3 years. Our goal is to get to 10%. We also give parents and students back 50% of their tuition paid via cash or credit card in the last semester if they graduate on time or early. So there's an incentive to finish early. We had a state grant for a couple of summers in which we allowed students to take 6 credits in the summer without paying tuition. They had to pay the fees, but not tuition. And so students took advantage of that. So there were multiple things that we did to really improve it. And as a result, our four-year graduation rate is up 22% over the course of my tenure, which is obviously a very significant increase and one that we're proud of and one that we think we could continue to improve on as well.
So how does Howard work to help students transition from the classroom to the workforce once they've graduated?
We have a career success office that we've stood up. And before we were almost solely focused on placement. Now we're focused on preparation, making sure that students are clear about what the workforce would look like. We also have a very strong workforce development program in which we are trying to get industry leaders, practitioners to co-teach our classes with our faculty. And we think that this is important because what happens is you tend to get more of a contemporary experience of what the workforce is going to be like, and therefore the students get a better preparation. You can have a finance professor who's been here for 20 years with all good intentions, teaching, you know, really good instruction, et cetera. But it's very different if you then bring in an investment banker or somebody in the investment world or banking world to co-teach a class with that person. So we've done that with Howard West, where we've sent our students out to Google, and they've been co-taught by Google engineers and Howard faculty. They also get credit at the same time, recognizing that with low-income students, having them participate in anything that doesn't contribute to their matriculation, I think, is difficult. And so you want to keep them moving along as well. We've been now doing it with Howard Entertainment at Amazon Studios. We have a group of students from 4 of our schools and colleges, law school, communications, our division of arts, fine arts, and our school of business students are out learning about making movies, music, but also looking at it from the C-suite perspective as well. And so that ability for practitioners to co-teach, I think, is very important in the preparation. And we've had some very early success doing that. And it's something that we're continuing to replicate and expand on.
Excellent. So the COVID-19 pandemic and the recession that came along with it have exposed a lot of the longstanding disparities in many aspects of American life. So whether we're talking about health outcomes or employment or education outcomes, I'm curious what your role as a HBCU leader, what role do you think HBCUs can play to help to address those disparities?
Yeah, you know, I think it's very important that we play that role. My research focuses on health disparities in cancer outcomes, as an example. And there are multiple areas of data and evidence that demonstrate that even if you take two people of the same socioeconomic status, but of different races or ethnicities, the outcomes are different in terms of how the medical system may interact with them. We see it in maternal mortality. College-educated Black women are far more likely to lose a child or to die during pregnancy than their white counterparts. And so there are things in our system that we have to continue to talk about and research and provide solutions, which is just as important. So during the pandemic, I think HBCUs played an important role. I know Howard certainly stepped up. We went out into Ward 7 and 8, that's 95% African-American, and set up a testing site. We now have a vaccination center. We've been very focused on vaccinating the minority community. And I think we've played an important role because we are seen as a trusted messenger.
As you look ahead as leader of Howard University and also the medical facilities that you guys have as well, what are you most hopeful about looking forward?
I'm pretty hopeful that this next generation is really going to do great things. You know, I think sometimes when you have national or international strife or crisis, what tends to happen is we tend to birth a golden generation. I think our young people that we have been so worried about are going to step up and do things differently. They would have been exposed to the fact that we're so interconnected. They would have been exposed to the fact that everybody from the gas attendant to the grocery store cashier to, you know, the gentlemen and women who work in, delivery services, et cetera, how important they are and how we have to embody the fullness of their humanity. And I think that this generation is going to grow up out of this with a unique thought process about their fellow citizens. And as a result, I think as they get into leadership, they're going to make decisions based on that. They're going to make decisions based on the fact that, you know, there really is no little guy, that we're all very important in the system to make it not just work, but to make it thrive. And so I'm hopeful that we're about to birth a golden generation that will really change things in a very positive way.
That's fantastic. And that's a great positive note for us to end on. I really appreciate your time this morning and all your insights. Excellent.
Thanks for having me. I appreciate it.
Thanks.
The COVID-19 pandemic has affected all higher ed institutions, no matter their size or geographic location. To better understand the differences and similarities of the challenges facing four-year institutions on opposite ends of the spectrum, I am now joined by Dr. Angel Cabrera, president of Georgia Tech University, a large public co-ed school in the middle of downtown Atlanta, and by Dr. Meredith Wu, president of Sweetbriar College, a small private women's liberal arts college in rural Virginia. I'm happy to be joined now by Dr. Angel Cabrera, president at Georgia Tech, and Dr. Meredith Wu, president at Sweetbriar College. And thanks so much for joining me this morning. So I'm excited to have this conversation today about COVID-19 and how it's impacted your colleges and also some plans going forward. So we'll jump right in to talk about that. And we'll start with Meredith. So college enrollment has declined nationwide in the past year, and which is unusual, right? During an economic downturn, typically we see college enrollment grow, but that's not what we've seen this year nationally. How was Sweetbriar's enrollment affected in the fall of 2020, and what's it looking like for fall 2021?
Well, thank you, Laura. To put this in context, you have brought us two extremes of the spectrum. We are very small, as Georgia Tech is very large. We are private, as Georgia Tech is public. And we are a single-sex school, as Georgia Tech is, of course, co-ed. And so I just wanted to put further in context a very unique situation of Sweetbriar, because Sweetbriar is exhibit A of what a niche school looks like. And so let me explain the niche first, and then I'll answer your question. Sweetbriar is a liberal arts college for women that offers really superlative education in a very small classroom setting. We are, for every six students or seven students, one faculty member. So we are very small in that sense in the classroom setting. And this is important for understanding the pandemic experience for us. And beyond that, we are very niche in the sense that in addition to being a women's college, we have a fully accredited, ABET accredited engineering program. And so let me put it like this. We gained enrollment, admissions, fall admissions in the fall of 2020 by about 20%. And then right now for fall of 2081, we're looking at something like 85% improvement in deposit over last year this time. And why is that? It's because it's in some ways, because of the traits that I described earlier, being a very small college in very large land in Central Virginia, what we have is we almost generically engineered to deal with the pandemic. We knew deep down in our hearts that if there is any college in America that could deal with pandemic, it would be us, because we had underutilized dorm rooms. We had huge space. It was a very healthful environment. And we had women and community that could take care of themselves and their colleagues.
And Hal, tell us a bit about the experience at Georgia Tech.
Well, thank you for having me. And Meredith is exactly right. You have chosen two schools in the opposite extremes. As you know, I mean, Georgia Tech is a technology-centered university in the middle of Midtown Atlanta and a thriving sort of innovation ecosystem that we have contributed to creating. And in our case, and this is just like Meredith's case is an exception to the rule. In our case, we are part of the rule, which is all the large schools and selective schools are seeing an increase in applications. This is something very interesting because the overall market has plateaued. The number of students coming out of high school has plateaued, and lower income students that have been very adversely affected by the pandemic are applying in less and less to college. I mean, this is something really that is concerning. So against those headwinds, schools like ours are having pretty dramatic increases in applications. So in the fall of 2020, we had a record 40,000 applications for an entering class that is a little bit over 3,000 students. And that in itself was a 14% increase with the prior year, which was also a record.
Wow.
Well, this year, in the middle of the pandemic, and we were concerned. We had no idea how this would affect the market. We had an 11% increase in applications for this coming fall. So there's something interesting happening. Students who apply are applying to more. They're applying to more schools. And I think all the uncertainty that COVID has created, once students and their families want to have options, there's also a lot of economic uncertainty, which makes students also to want to have options even on the economic spectrum, depending on not knowing how the economic winds are going to affect them. And even in the number of first generation low income applicants who are applying at a lower rate than before the pandemic, as I said, which is very, very concerning. But even those, they are applying, they're more likely to apply to highly selective schools.
To follow up a bit about admissions for this year, I know Georgia Tech, like many other schools, dropped the requirement of ACT, SAT for this year. Is this something you were talking about pre-pandemic, or was this solely because of the COVID-19 pandemic? And what do you see happening going forward?
Yes, Laura. So we've been having this conversation for years, even before my arrival to Georgia Tech in 2019. But the board, which has entertained this question, has consistently fallen on the side of keeping the test. So for years the conversations have been taking place just like in the rest of the country, but the board consistently sided on that. This year, we pretty much had no choice. I mean, the difficulties in just taking the test forced all of us to go. So it became a natural experiment, right? So we had in the overall number of students who were accepted, 21% of those students did not have testing considered. But for first generation students, 50% of the accepted, more than twice, right, were admitted without testing. Lower income students and first generation students normally score on average lower than higher income students and students from families whose parents have gone to college, which is, by the way, one of the very reasons that are utilized to argue against standardized tests, which is this uneven impact that standardized tests have. So in a way, many first generation or low income students do not they normally apply to selective schools at lower rates because they feel like they have a lower chance of getting in because they're normally their standardized tests. So when you remove that from the equation, I think that explains, at least to a great extent, that explains why many of those low-income students and first-generation students say, hey, this is my chance to apply to more selective schools. And many of them are getting in because they demonstrate huge potential through their GPAs, through their performance in their high school. So we sort of, if you will, the hypothesis that we were testing in this natural experiment is, could we increase diversity in our institutions if you go test optional? And the answer seems to be at least likely so.
One of the things we're focusing on in this series is the connection from education to the workforce and how that's been impacted by COVID. So how do you work with students after they've graduated to transition to the workforce? And how do you help them make sure that transition is successful?
So one way we think about manpower training is this. Well, when you look at the economy of the Commonwealth of Virginia, in the private economy, the greatest sector is bar none agriculture. So in the last couple of years, we invested in 20 acres of vineyard because Commonwealth of Virginia is the fourth most important wine producing state in the union. We created one of the largest greenhouses, state of the art, that you will find around in Virginia, which is 27,000 acres of greenhouse to produce the food for our own students and to teach our students how to grow things. If you're looking at the percentage of women as primary agricultural operators nationally, it's probably about 21-22%. In the Commonwealth of Virginia, it's 39%, 40%, right? So because of a particular type of agriculture here connected to artisanal agriculture, wine producing, tourism, you have vast involvement of women as primary agricultural producers. We looked at that and we said, well, we can see a path forward where this sector is the sector that we can train women for. And so that's one way we think about how to connect education to manpower workforce training.
So, Angel, you know, one of the things that as economists that we've spent a lot of time looking at and talking about is how the COVID-19 pandemic has just laid bare already existing disparities, right, that we knew existed, and it's just exacerbated those. And you've mentioned the decline in low-income enrollment. And so I'm curious, what role do you see Georgia Tech playing in the issues to address disparities?
That's a great question, and you're absolutely right to point out that the pandemic has, if anything, exacerbated differences. So we have a great risk that is becoming harder for low-income students to go to top-performing colleges, which, as we know, is the safest route into a middle-class life. And then even when you're in college, what we're detecting is that students who may have less of a social capital to rely on. If you're a first-generation student and you don't have people in your immediate family and your immediate circle that can orient you and connect you to get into the right places to get the right kind of employment, you're also going to suffer. So we're keenly aware of that and trying to do our best to counter those effects. Every time I look around, what I see is a sea of diverse talent right around us. In the Atlanta public schools are a majority minority system. So we're working with Atlanta public schools. We've had a good experiment now running for several years, where if you are a valedictorian or a salutatorian in any of the classes, not only you have direct acceptance to Georgia Tech, but there's a very generous scholarship. What we're now doing is do a guaranteed transfer. So even if you graduate from an Atlanta public school and you may not make the cut as a freshman to come in, here's a path. You know, you go to you go somewhere else, you take these classes, you meet this this GPA, and we'll guarantee you accept. We have a program called Project Engages, where we have high school students from Atlanta public schools who spend the summer interning in a lab. Again, these are students who they don't see scientists in their daily lives, and all of a sudden they're in a lab with a white coat and they're pipetting and they're doing real work. They get some money as well, and all of a sudden they see themselves as scientists. I mean, if you can't see it, if you cannot imagine yourself, then it's not even in the realm of possibility. So we know what works. We just need to make sure we're expanding those programs.
Has there been a change that Sweetbriar has made due to the pandemic? So something that happened directly because of the pandemic that you plan to keep in place going forward after the pandemic ends?
You know, the pandemic year has been incredibly educational for Sweetbriar. It validated that what we have is gold, because it validated that a small college that can disperse students in the classroom, we had no difficulties with social distancing, but you know, we just turned the college into a plexiglass wonderland, but delivered education as best we could. It validated for us that a liberal arts college that delivers superlative education in a small classroom setting is gold. You know, when everybody says you want to go left with online education, we are going right. You know, I think what we have is a good thing.
So if you were in charge for a day, if you're the big boss man of all policy for one day, what's the one policy change you would make that would benefit your institution or your students the most?
Double pay. I mean, we have a program that a national program that works, a program that has a big impact in higher education participation of people lower means. And by doubling, by the way, it's not just necessarily doubling the amounts, but also even changing the qualification criteria. But to me, that would be we know that the post-pandemic economy is going to be increasingly a knowledge economy. I mean, a college degree was always important to allow you to get access to that good job, good employment with good benefits in that middle class life that is sort of our collective aspiration. It was always helpful. Now it's necessary. So if you really want to work on social mobility and opportunity, one policy, double tell.
Meredith, how about you? What one policy change would you make?
Well, I love Ahel, and I'm going to repeat after him, double pell. It's really important. And for reasons that Ahel just mentioned, well, put a different spin on this, right? Why for us private institutions, doubling the amount of Pell is so important and for our society. Let me use the example from the Commonwealth of Virginia, right? If you look at private institutions, independent colleges in the Commonwealth, about 42% of our students are Pell grant recipients. If you look at public institutions that are flagship, it's about 10%. And what worries me is that there are a lot of suggestions on the table, such as free public institutions or free community colleges. All of this sounds really good, and all of this sounds really populist, but the fact of the matter is that given the statistics that I have just recited of the percentage of Pell Grant recipients in flagship universities, what this really translates into is a policy that's deeply regressive, and that you end up supporting, once again, subsidizing wealthy folks from Northern Virginia, perhaps, rather than really trying to tackle with evidence in an intelligent way the longstanding disparity issues that our country faces. And so double Pell, yes, I think I agree with Ahel.
Yeah, that's interesting. You know, that's a great example, I think, of how you have two institutions that are so different, but then one policy that it would be so impactful to you in potentially different ways, slightly different ways, but still that's really interesting. That says a lot. So Meredith, as you look forward into 2021-22, the next school year and going forward, what are you most hopeful about?
Well, in general, when I look at students who are age 18 to 22, what gives me most hope about the future of this country and the world is the students' concern for social justice. I think it really bodes very well for what kind of leadership this country will have. It seems to me that the leadership that the students will play going forward will be much more inclusive, much more horizontal, much more collaborative, and much more diplomatic, full of respect for each other. And so that gives me a lot of hope.
Angel, what about you? What are you most hopeful about looking forward?
You know, this is the year also the year of science and the year of technology. And actually in the last decade or so, we have been sort of an interesting decline in trust about science and questioning universities and questioning science. And when things got really, really ugly, when they got scary, we realized that science is all we got, and science and technology. We have never in our history developed a vaccine this quickly. And it's sort of like the old adage of it takes decades to be an overnight success. I mean, yes, this was an overnight success that had taken decades of investment, of work in labs and in universities all over the world. Science works, y'all. So, and it is science and it's technology. I mean, the reason the way we kept our economy going, the way we kept many of our jobs going, was because of these telecommunication tools, the Blue Jeans, the Zooms, the Google, the Microsoft tools at our disposal. Without this, our economy would have come to a halt. So what I'm hopeful is that this is like a reminder that when things get really, really scary, science and technology is all we got. And we were able to figure out the solutions. And if we can find the solutions to the problem of the coronavirus pandemic, we should be able to find solutions to the other big questions of our time, whether it's climate change, whether it's economic inequality, access to food and hunger, the list goes on. So there is, I think I'm closing this dark year with a sense of great optimism about the future and a great really confidence in what we do in places like Georgia Tech, science and technology. Science works, y'all.
That's an excellent place for us to end our discussion, because you've both left me hopeful as well. And I really appreciate your time that you've given us today, and your insights are incredibly valuable. And I wish you both the best of luck as you close out this school year.
Thank you for having us.
Thanks. Thanks, Meredith.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Before we get into session 6, however, we want to highlight an issue that came up repeatedly in earlier conversations throughout this series. It's an unexpected silver lining in the pandemic, and one that we didn't expect to hear about. The shift to remote learning during the COVID-19 pandemic has allowed some institutions the ability to bring a higher quality education to underserved populations, including incarcerated students.
One of our schools is students that are incarcerated, and to me, it's one of the success stories of this pandemic. These are young people who've had interactions with the law. These are young people who, in large part, we failed in K-12 education.
Community colleges are one of the only forms of higher education for our prison population. Each year, we graduate hundreds of students in our prison population. So initially, we were able to access those justice-involved students, but as time wore on, the three correctional facilities that we service in our area had no choice but to restrict visitors from coming into those facilities. We still were persistent, and we used packet instructions, but it certainly is not a replacement for our instructors going into the prison system and having the opportunity to teach those classes.
Our future economic growth depends in part on the size of our workforce. But with falling birth rates and an aging population, demographics are not on our side. So where can we find additional workers? One place to look is on the sidelines of the labor market, at people who could be working but aren't. Over the past 50 years, the male labor force participation rate in the United States has fallen more than 10 percentage points, from 80% in 1970 to 69% in January 2020. During the pandemic, it has fallen even further. There are a lot of factors behind this decline: shifts in U.S. industry structure, delayed family formation, falling male educational attainment, an aging population, higher rates of illness, disability, and addiction, and even heavy use of video games. But contact with the criminal justice system is another challenge. A 2014 survey indicated that a third of non-working prime-age males have criminal records. A criminal record makes individuals ineligible for many jobs, and it makes employers hesitant to hire. And incarceration represents a large rupture in a person's ability to invest in their own human capital. Our research finds that incarceration has enormous effects on earnings and employment, particularly for men with less education. First-time incarceration reduces the expected lifetime earnings of high school graduates by 33% for Black men and 43% for white men. The larger percent decline for white men reflects the fact that white high school graduates have higher earnings than Black high school graduates on average. This massive reduction in lifetime earnings is largely due to a reduction in the average number of working years, 7.6 fewer for Black men and 9.4 fewer for white men. There is also a strong link between becoming incarcerated and joblessness. So incarceration leads not only to lower earnings, but also to persistently lower employment rates later in life.
Many of those that are incarcerated, their pending release is imminent. So it is important for them to have those skill sets that they've already taken the time while incarcerated to achieve, so that once they're released into the general public, they have those skill sets. It is crucially important to us as a society to continue to educate all of our citizens, because oftentimes inmates are in because they've made just one bad choice. It certainly doesn't mean that they're any less intelligent, and it certainly doesn't mean that they're any less positive.
Recidivism rates are highest amongst those that were incarcerated at younger ages and those with less than a high school diploma. And so it is these same groups that stand to gain the most from education. Those who participate in educational opportunities while incarcerated are 43% less likely to return to prison, according to some studies. And because we know there is a strong relationship between educational attainment and participation in the labor force generally, it stands to reason that those formerly incarcerated that get more education will be more likely to participate in the labor force. And the expansion of virtual learning during the pandemic only increases these educational opportunities for incarcerated students.
We've ordered IT equipment that will now allow us to offer remote learning. So we're excited about the fact that moving forward, there will be more and more synchronous learning that we're able to do with those classrooms and be able to still reach that population of students.
They have successfully now taken two semesters of college courses, two or three college courses at the University of Baltimore, and many of them are telling us it has been the best academic experience they've ever had. And if it weren't for the virtual environment and their ability to actually be part of a community of learning, we never would have known that, because most people don't think of students with interactions with the law as being capable of that level of work, and they have proven that they are.
Welcome back, and I'm so glad you've joined us for this, our final session of District Dialogues. Getting a degree or certificate is one thing. Getting a job is another, especially during a pandemic. We're going to talk with researchers and businesses about how we can effectively connect people to in-demand jobs and secure their attachment to the labor force, particularly given the ways the labor market is changing and evolving. If you're watching live, please type any questions or comments into the chat. I'll be monitoring them live so that I can respond. We also hope that you'll join in the conversation on social media using the hashtag District Dialogues. If you're watching a replay, please continue to use the hashtag so that we can have an ongoing conversation about these issues. And be sure to tag us in your social media posts so that we'll see them. First, let's look at the big picture of how COVID-19 might affect the labor market long-term and the overall future of work in the United States. I'm joined by Dr. Elizabeth Reynolds, who was a principal research scientist and executive director of the MIT Industrial Performance Center and executive director of MIT's Task Force on the Work of the Future. As of April 1st, 2021, Elizabeth is on leave from MIT and serving on the National Economic Council as a special assistant to the president for manufacturing and economic development. Thanks so much, Elizabeth, for joining me this morning.
Such a pleasure to be here, Laura. Really excited to speak with you.
Yeah, so let's start very big picture. So countries around the world have had very different experiences with the pandemic. It's certainly been global, but the experience has not been the same from place to place across multiple dimensions. So if we think specifically about the labor market, how do U.S. government institutions, so things such as unemployment insurance, how does that differ in the U.S. compared to other developed nations? And what do you think the impact of that was?
I think first and foremost, we should recognize that, you know, a lot of countries, including the U.S., really kicked into gear last spring and, you know, spent incredible amounts and got a tremendous amount of funding and support out first and foremost. And so that's important. And then, as you point out, there were real differences, that sort of the institutional differences across countries were made apparent, certainly in the labor market, but also in our healthcare systems. And, you know, I think this is in some ways a wake up call in terms of what does it tell us about the challenges we have going ahead and sort of where we have a lot of weaknesses. The tide went out, I think, on the U.S. labor market. And what we saw is that we really have, you know, a shadow labor market where a good percentage of workers do not have unemployment insurance, do not have any healthcare benefits, and are left really high and dry, so to speak, in the moment of that crisis. And so in the German system, for example, the unemployment insurance is much more generous, covers many more people. So in the moment of crisis, whether that's an external shock or something that's happened for internally for the country, the government steps in and has been subsidized essentially employment for employers, and they will cover some of the cost. And workers are also going on short-term work breaks. So you break up, you know, the 40-hour week to something less than. And that keeps people employed. It keeps businesses open. The U.S., on the other hand, has an unemployment insurance system that is very highly variable across states, that doesn't cover anyone who's working part-time, that it has, you know, sort of maxes out or tops out when based on earnings and not hours worked, that has a no ability to cover gig workers, et cetera. And I think to our credit and to the government's credit, the effort to, in the middle of the pandemic, to extend unemployment insurance in many ways, I think was very important, has continued. And I hope those are changes that will stay throughout, you know, be made permanent. But our system has the dynamism that we've always sort of said there's
an upside to that. But of course, the downside is in these moments where so many people have been left in the lurch. We certainly see a lot of dynamism right now in our economy in terms of the sort of signs of the economy coming back.
It's really a really incredible growth that we're seeing, but still a lot of jobs that existed in February 2020 that haven't come back. So it's a very interesting time for sure. So people have been worried about for decades that automation was going to take away American jobs, right? This fear that there would be a robot replacing manufacturing workers, for example. And certainly technology can replace a lot of human interaction. But on the other hand, what we've gone through recently, I think, has shown us that many jobs in our economy truly are essential, right? So which story do you think that will dominate in years to come? And does that differ by industry?
I think one thing we need to remember is that while technology certainly replaces jobs and has hollowed out a lot of the jobs, particularly in manufacturing, we've seen automation hit hard there, it also creates a lot of jobs. Over 60% of the jobs that exist today did not exist 80 years ago. And we don't have that kind of long-term view, but we have, you know, that's part of why we need an innovation agenda, which really invests in the jobs and the industries of the future. And so what actually our challenge going forward is not going to be that we don't have enough jobs. So the challenge, though, is the quality of those jobs. What we've seen is the quality of jobs, particularly for sort of middle and lower skilled workers, has declined such that the U.S. has some of the worst paid low wage work in the industrialized world. And so I think that in our mind is going to be the bigger challenge for us. In fact, you know, what we've seen again is that technology is it's replacing and it's creating. And it's also it tends to replace on the lower skilled work and complement on the higher skilled work. So really what we want to be doing is bringing everyone up to some of the more skilled work and using technology as a tool in that case.
How has that been exacerbated by the pandemic, do you think?
We've seen already that the impact of COVID was disproportionately felt by lower wage workers in the service industry, right? We have a knock-on effect of all of the hospitality, retail, travel-related industries, et cetera. There is a sense that companies have, they learned to work with fewer workers. And that's sort of something they're not going to unlearn over time. At the same time, what we've seen is a need for people to actually adjust. You know, a lot of things aren't replaceable by the technology, and the technology and the automation that's coming is in many ways for those firms that can make those investments. And again, it requires capital, and firms haven't had that capital necessarily, at least the smaller, medium-sized firms haven't had that capital. But when they can make that investment, what we're seeing in many cases is that what they're looking at is technology that can actually augment workers, not necessarily completely replace them. I think there's also productivity gains that'll come out of that will hopefully be translated, importantly, need to be translated into sort of gains that workers also experience.
Yeah, great points. So something that I'm really interested in as a regional economist for the Federal Reserve is the urban-rural dynamic and how that might change because of COVID. And so I'm curious, I know you've spent a lot of your career studying urban economics. And so do you anticipate any long-term or longer-term shifts in the urban-rural dynamic coming out of the pandemic?
Well, I have to say, I am not someone who believes that, you know, cities are over. I think the salience and importance of cities has time and time again been underscored, and that the value of proximity of to our social well-being, to our innovation capacity, et cetera, is paramount, and that will, you know, cities will bounce back. They will look different, though. I think we see that with the now introduction of remote work. The sort of commercial real estate will look different. Maybe that'll change what the residential real estate looks like, etc. So there is that kind of knock-on effect. And I think there's positive effects for those cities that are then not kind of the largest and first tier cities, but the second tier smaller cities, mid-sized cities who are seeing sort of an exodus where people are deciding for those who can work remotely that they're going to move to other places, that that's going to actually have a bump up effect for some of these mid-tier cities. Now, in terms of urban rural, I don't know if we'll see that kind of dramatic impact. What I will say, I think that's important, again, in terms of the theme about quality of work, is that my colleague David Otter's research has shown that people used to move to the city for a sort of the urban escalator to a middle skilled job. So if you had low skills and low wage work, you'd move to the city, you'd find a job and you'd move up, you know, and find better work and better pay. And what his research has shown is that urban wage premium has really disappeared. And so I think that's a disincentive in many ways for people who are living in rural areas to actually move to the big city.
So we've talked a little bit already about how lower wage workers were disproportionately hit by the pandemic. A lot of employers we're talking to in our role are saying they're having a hard time filling low wage jobs right now. And so it's an interesting dynamic. Unemployment rates higher than we would typically like to see, but still we're hearing about a lot of employment shortages. Are you concerned about longer term effects and scarring on the labor market from this experience?
I would be concerned, as always, about long term unemployment effects. We know that those who stay out of the labor market for longer than 6 months have a harder time getting back into the labor market. I certainly have concerns about women. We've seen how women have, disproportionately stepped out of the labor market, and the best case scenario, we're back up to pre-pandemic labor participation rates in a few years. But I think that's, we're going to require a lot of work to make that happen. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, dislocated workers, as you said earlier, we're imagining there'll be just swaths of jobs that don't exist anymore. And so what happens to those workers? How do we get them redeployed into careers and pathways that take them, again, to that middle skill job? And I've been encouraged by a number of states who have stepped up to try and help, anybody who's been hit by that, providing subsidized education, pathways to new careers, Michigan introducing free community college for those entering into the healthcare industry, where there's a tremendous amount of growth and demand.
Typically when the economy is in a downturn, community college enrollment jumps. And in the 5th District to the Federal Reserve during the last recession, community college enrollment grew by over 20%. I mean, it was really, really extreme growth. But this time we've seen a different pattern. So even as the economy went into a recession this last year, overall community college enrollment dropped around 10%, it looks like, in fall 2020, and it's still down about the same in spring 2021. So does this concern you? And do you think it's all about the pandemic?
Yeah, so I don't personally think it's all about the pandemic. I think it's hard for us to read into dynamics with pandemic and, social distancing and remote work and remote classes and things and what's actually been going on. But you're right that the trend was there previously. I think we have to point to affordability, just that people's ability to access higher education and pay for it has been, challenging. And I think there's also potentially the impact of multiple pathways. We've had this, what my former colleague Paul Ostman would call, we have the Wild West of certifications going on. So we have, many interesting, possibly excellent online certification programs that have emerged from companies like Google and Microsoft and others. And they have very promising early results, but we don't necessarily know long-term what it means for someone to do a stackable credentials versus a two-year community college degree, all of that. So I feel like there's a little bit of confusion in many ways as to what somebody coming out of high school and looking for kind of additional education should be looking for and what the best pathways are forwarded. So I think one of the key recommendations we made in our MIT's Task Force on the Work of the Future report was around the importance of rigorous evaluation of these programs. What I will say is I feel like there's a lot of innovation and experimentation. People understand that the old system needs to be a little bit more dynamic and responsive. And so what we've seen, you know, community colleges, you know, the two-year degree they now offer four-year degrees, or they're partnering with the four-year institution. They're certainly partnering with the high schools. So there's a lot of great models out there.
Yeah. So if you were talking to somebody that was a dislocated worker right now, or someone that was thinking about going back to school, what advice would you give them based on the work you do?
Obviously, the first part is to be mindful of areas of figuring out where the growth opportunities are, where is the drive, and where are the jobs and industries that are looking promising, particularly for that middle skill job, for that middle wage job we're trying to really create. And so clearly healthcare is an area of great growth. And surprisingly, we've had manufacturing has been a really strong area through the pandemic, and is again short workers. Obviously logistics and warehousing and all that's going on that's related to that has sort of a byproduct of e-commerce is also involved. And then the trades, we've seen a lot going on in construction and areas like that. The president of MIT, President Raphael Reif, often talks about make sure the next generation is bilingual. And what he means by bilingual is we have foundational skills in math related, you know, data interpretation, facility with technology, along with an understanding of the social sciences and the human element of all the important skills, right, that we know about, judgment, team building, creativity, all of those things. You want both in how we're educating the next generation. And so looking at a program that's going to provide the foundational skills you need in both of those areas. And then ideally what we see is you get a specialization. So you want the foundational skills with some layer of specialization that helps people sort of find the career path and be able to you know, climb a career ladder. Current workers have a skill set, a foundational skill set that's solid, and you can layer on to that the new skills that people need. It's not like we need a whole new workforce. We have foundational skills. You can build upon them.
To finish out, I want to know, have you learned anything from the pandemic that makes you really hopeful for the future?
The first thing I would say that can't be, I think, understated is the important role of government here. You know, where would we be if we're not able to mobilize resources? It's not something that the philanthropy can do. It's not something the private sector was in a position to do in terms of the scale of operation. So, you know, and that's kind of hopeful. Like, look what we could do in the face of a global pandemic. The second part was adaptability. And I guess that you know, we are, humans are adaptable, and people made unbelievable sacrifices and did incredible things to help us get through, you know, to where we are today. I think one of the big things here was to see how quickly firms could adapt. And then I'm incredibly hopeful that we are going to, you know, because of the exposure of the weaknesses in our system, the institutions where people were really left behind, we're going to look to come back with institutions in a stronger way, invest in fixing where we saw those gaps, and be prepared for the next crisis. There will be one, but actually be prepared for a better and more robust kind of economy and more inclusive economy, in a way in which we can bring more people into a pathway forward. And I think I'm hopeful about that.
That's great. That's a great place for us to wrap up. Now I'm excited to talk with some companies in our district who are finding ways to connect with workers and retain employees, even during uncertain times. Gat Caperton is the CEO of Gat Creek Furniture in Berkeley Springs, West Virginia, and Paul Sinanian is the manager of BMW Manufacturing's apprenticeship program in Spartanburg, South Carolina. Paul and Gat, thanks so much for joining me this morning.
Thank you. Great to be here.
So, Paul, I'll ask you to respond to this first question. I know your industry requires a really unique set of skills to produce your products, which are BMWs. How do you recruit talent to your organization, and specifically for you as you're looking for apprentices?
Well, one of the biggest things that we have is our apprentice program is close to 100 people at any given time, and it's a two-year program. What we've seen is opportunities to expand that program. So we are actually kicking two new aspects of our program off this year. One aspect would actually go into the high schools. So South Carolina has opened the door for industry to go into high schools and actually with the local career centers, bring students that are in their senior year into industry. So that would take our two-year program to a three-year program. And then on the other side of that, we've never tapped into those that already have an associate's degree, that experience level that will be able to walk in with experience that we would then shrink our program from 2 years to 1 year, and then actually utilize that for full on-the-job training and then accelerate their possibility to come into the company.
Excellent. Excellent. So Gat, you're also in manufacturing, furniture manufacturing. How do you recruit talent with the skills you need to produce the furniture?
So we have just about as many employees as Paul has trainees and interns. So we're about 150 people. So we have a little easier task. And historically, we've had very low turnover. So a 20% turnover rate, which means we really need to go and find historically three or four people a month. Now we're a growing business and have to have, we're trying to hire 10, 15 a month if we can. We're really trying to learn how to recruit people. And what we found is, We stay in communications with our local schools. I think that's going to be more and more people coming in. That's easy part. But a lot of it is folks that are leaving town. They're driving to the larger cities, to Winchester or Hagerstown or Martinsburg to work. And we're trying to pick them off so that they can stay home and work locally.
Great. So, Gat, we're hearing from people that that they're having trouble finding workers. Are you finding the people that you need, or are you struggling to find people that have the skills that you need right now?
Yeah, we're adding people, but it's hard to add people as fast as we need to right now, especially with the COVID. There's just absenteeism that you just don't normally have in a workplace. So the need is significant.
So it wasn't as much of a challenge prior to COVID.
It was not. We're an area that's always been a competitive area for workers. There's always been relatively low, lower than average unemployment where we are. So, our approach to it is we're really a lifestyle type of a place to work. And we really try to, have a family orientation. We're very fortunate that we don't have to run three shifts and do shift work. So we're able to have a story that you can work Monday, early Monday morning till Friday afternoon and be on a lifestyle that isn't too punishing to you than the rest of your life. That's one of our big recruiting tools that's been very helpful to us.
Great. So Paul, how about at BMW? Are you having trouble finding apprentices? Have you noticed a difference during COVID?
Actually not. I mean, we've got a number of things, of variables that we have to deal with. One of them is growth. We've had a significant amount of growth at BMW over the past decade. But factor that into our workforce really changing demographics. The workforce is starting to retire, so we're on a constant replacement cycle. And we've worked very closely with the high schools and career centers and the technical schools in order to keep this pipeline going. What we're struggling with is really now that the focus on more of a electrical, electronics, track and robotics and controls, these are the areas of the industry that really the entire industry is starving for people. So we're focused on really getting some of that pipeline moving with the technical colleges, and they've reacted and really it's now reaching into the high schools to make sure that is seen as an attractive path of employment and a career. And it really is starting to gain momentum. So while we're fortunate to have that local pipeline network, we still have to make sure that we're working that on a regular basis.
So when you're looking, I understand that there are particular technical skills that people absolutely need to do the work that you're hiring for. But what other general skills and characteristics are you looking for when you're hiring apprentices?
We're looking for people that we can put into multiple areas within the organization. We're looking for somebody to come in and build a career. So really, we're looking at it not as just one person with a set of skills that's just technical, but it's the full array of technical leadership, quality skills, and really being able to build a career for several different roles in the plant.
What Paul does is very similar to us, is that we really have a long-term kind of orientation where we're looking for people that want to do a career with us and that we can have and work with for a long time, because we just find, you know, the longer someone's working at our facility, the better and better they get skill-wise. Obviously, we're looking for folks that are good problem solvers, people that are just generally energetic and the kind of people you'd want to be around. A lot of our training is very apprenticeship-based. It's really working side-by-side with somebody, and having someone that's going to be long-term is just valuable to us. We don't have many kind of jobs that are mindless jobs. That's one of the kind of cool things about being in woodworking. It's there's no repetitive mindless jobs here. So we really look for aptitude more so than experience specific to woodworking.
How do you encourage retention of those employees? How do you keep your good people?
One of the things we like to say, I use a little less colorful language, but you know, the best way to have a crummy employee is to have a crummy job. So you really want to make jobs that are, you know, good and exciting to be in, and are interesting jobs. So, you know, that's part of it. We want to be a place that's safe, both, you know, physically feel safe, but safe, a place that you come in and be around. And, you know, in terms of really long-term employees, I think the relationship that an employee has with someone else in their workplace is probably the most important relationships they have. It is the person you work next to that ultimately defines how your experience, a lot of your experience is there. So we really like to find people that, get along and, you know, kind of come in and have a family feeling, you know, engage with their fellow employees. And that makes the day a little more fun, makes the job a little better.
Well, and I really like what Gad said just a few seconds ago, and I'll reiterate that. I'm looking for problem solvers. And problem solvers can come in so many varieties. So what they need to come in with is the right attitude, the right mindset, and really we're focused on culture, because ultimately it's about people working together with people. And the other thing is, and to the crummy job, I resonate with that, because I'm thinking the same things, because I tell them, have fun at work. Come in and, you know, we're driving being innovative. We're driving being excited. You know, we're driving all these things that you should be having fun with. And that is something about culture. And really, I think you can have any strategy you want. And as Drucker said, you can culture eat strategy for lunch. It's just that simple.
That's great. Do you think there are other strategies that employers could pursue to try to draw people in from the sidelines of the workforce?
Yeah, I think this is one of the big opportunities, one of the things we actually focus a lot on. And you know, in our factory, we're 53% women. Our factory floor really reflects our community in terms of who's on there. We're really focused in our operation to make it a place where, you know, everyone, you know, every potential employee could be feel that they could be successful in it. It's, you know, it's making it a, you know, a good environment to walk in, a safe environment. And that's been one of the keys for us to fill in jobs in our operation. We've got a good number of folks that have retired, retired relatively young. That some have, and most recently, a lot of have moved out of education, K-12 education. And we've been able to pick up those folks by making it a place that they wouldn't first think about going to. But if we're able to get them in and show them that it's an environment that's engaging and interesting and you can be solving problems. And I think we have to look these days, in particular, the broad workforce. And if you look at a narrow slice of the workforce, you're missing a lot of opportunity and a lot of skill that we need these days.
Great point. So, Paul, what do you think?
Well, I think the biggest thing that, and we went through this with our apprentice program last year with our two new programs that we added on is to challenge traditional understanding of where that workforce is coming from. And I think Gat put it right, that thin slice, even though it's been productive in the past, you always have to say, okay, what would happen if this went away? And are we actually looking at more opportunities and, you know, diversity and inclusion to being one? I think the biggest thing the organization has to do is first accept that there is a different way that you could actually look at and challenge everything you're doing to see if it's the right thing or if it can be done differently. I think the biggest thing that employers fall into is they get complacent.
Great.
And I'll add to that, what's really nice these days today is technology creates a lot of those opportunities that we just historically wouldn't have had. And these CNC machines, you don't have to be a traditional manufacturing guy to successfully operate a CNC machine and other stuff like that. And I know BMW does it to a T, but think it through the ergonomics and think it through the technology. It's created a lot of opportunities for people that we probably wouldn't have had 15, 20 years ago.
Excellent. Well, thank you both so much for your time this morning. This is a great conversation. And, the whole world, I think, is watching to see what happens post-COVID. And that connection from education to the workforce is going to be a really important part of the equation. So I appreciate your time.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you to everyone who joined us for District Dialogues and shared their experiences and insights. COVID-19 has had a significant effect on education in the United States, and it has highlighted and exacerbated longstanding disparities within our educational system. But as we learned throughout the 6 sessions of District Dialogues, there are dedicated teachers, administrators, researchers, nonprofit workers, business owners, and communities working together on innovative solutions to support students no matter the circumstances. Thank you for watching and for contributing to this important conversation. If you missed any of the previous episodes, you can watch them on our YouTube channel. We hope you'll continue to be part of the dialogue.